a place where miracles happen. Men and women who go there may be healed, healed in their body or healed in their soul. A cancer disappears, an eye sees, a broken heart is appeased. The cures happen to humble people. Many are documented, scientifically proven. We are in Lourdes in the south of France. Beyond are the Pyrenees Mountains, on the other side of which is Spain, and further on, Portugal and Fatima.
The most inspiring things here in Lourdes is just the overall sense of peace that I get from being here. It's so beautiful, the churches, but also the nature surrounding it.
Lourdes is known inside the sanctuary, which is huge. It's a big place of holiness, proclaimed by the church after an investigation that this is Holy Land.
C'est à la fois la personnalité de Bernadette, c'est les apparitions, c'est le signe de l'eau.
The story of Lourdes begins with a young girl. She is 14 and her name is Bernadette Soubirous. Even though living in France, she does not speak French well, but instead the local dialect. She was born into a poor family. Her father, a miller of flour, too generous with his bread, is now bankrupt. The family lives in a partial basement. Bernadette, having had cholera in her childhood, has breathing problems from the humidity of the common room. One Friday in 1854, she is gathering firewood with two companions in order to sell it and bring the money home. Beyond the River Gave, there is a grotto, home to choice driftwood. Her companions, Toinette and Jean, take off their shoes to cross the water, but Bernadette hesitates.
I asked the two others to help me throw stones into the water to see if I could cross without taking off my shoes, but it was no good, so I came back.
Bernadette is frequently sick and suffers from severe asthma.
4 years ago, I was diagnosed with leukemia. And I have had many chemotherapy treatments. I've been in the hospital around 400 days as an inpatient, even many more as an outpatient, going every day for tests and treatments. I've had two bone marrow stem cell transplants, and I'm still not healed or cured. Nothing really seemed to work for me.
In 1972, I began to have neurological problems. In 1984, I was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, a serious illness which is progressive and incurable.
Many people who are sick come to Lourdes, even the physically healthy. Everyone has something to heal.
Hardly had I taken off my first stocking when I heard a noise as if a sudden wind blew. I turned my head and looked at the meadow, and I saw that the trees were still. I went on taking off my stocking, and again I heard the same sound as I lifted up my head to look at the grotto. I saw a lady dressed in white. She wore a white dress, an equally white veil, a blue belt, and a yellow rose on each foot.
Above the right side of the cave, surrounded by ivy, is a crevice. Bernadette sees a young woman there. At first, she calls her the lady.
A lady, young and beautiful, exceedingly beautiful, the like of whom I had never seen. She came and placed herself at the entrance of the opening above the bush. She looked at me immediately, smiled at me, and signed me to advance, as if she had been my mother.
Si nous regardons du côté gauche de la grotte, nous voyons la foule ininterrompue de gens, des gens qui rentrent. Chacun avec le visage très grave, chacun portant ses propres intentions, ses propres difficultés, ses propres souffrances, souvent avec des drames terribles dans la vie de beaucoup de personnes. Donc les visages sont très marqués, c'est un moment tout à fait solennel.
The archives of Lourdes are full of touching stories of the visitors who have come to the shrine. In 1875, there was Pierre de Ruder. Pierre had fallen off a tree and crushed his leg. The result was an open fracture of the left tibia. Despite all treatment, the leg never healed. 8 years later, he is a pitiful sight on his way to Lourdes. His leg swings back and forth for lack of rigidity. In 1937, there was Louise Jamain. She had pulmonary and intestinal tuberculosis. Her mother and four brothers had already died from the disease. On her journey to Lourdes, she has several hemorrhages. 1892, Elisa Lesage. 1893, Abbé Siret. 1905, Cécile Duville. 1950, Francis Pascal. 1950, Avasio Gonora.
Et puis nous voyons les mêmes personnes qui ressortent à droite de la grotte. Elles sont entrées, elles ont fait de façon mystérieuse l'expérience d'une rencontre. Et ces mêmes personnes ressortent avec le visage grave peut-être, marqué par la souffrance, la douleur, les préoccupations. Mais sur le visage, il y a déjà de la lumière.
I rubbed my eyes. I shut them. I opened them. But the lady was still there, continuing to smile at me and making me understand that I was not mistaken. I took my rosary in my hands and fell on my knees. The lady made a sign of approval with her head and took into her hands a rosary which hung on her right arm. When I attempted to begin the rosary and tried to lift my hand to my forehead, my arm remained paralyzed. And it was only after the lady had signed herself that I could do the same. Only at the end of each decade did she say the glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
From the opposite shore, Toinette and Jean Abadie watch Bernadette praying.
Look at Bernadette down there saying her prayers. What a prig! She must be mad to be praying there.
Bernadette asks the girls to say nothing at home. But her sister says everything to Madame Soubirous that very evening. Soon the news spreads. Bernadette's father proposes a remedy to dispel the vision, a good beating. But Bernadette is drawn to the place.
Back in, I'm going to say, April of this year, I really got the call in my heart from Mary to come to Lourdes and pray with her.
At the start of October 1987, my friends talked me into making a pilgrimage to Lourdes.
Three days later, Bernadette is permitted to return to the grotto. This time she goes with a few adult friends, as well as 20 other children. The lady appears. A prudent onlooker has given Bernadette some holy water to throw at this person, just in case. So Bernadette sprinkles the water, and the lady smiles. Bernadette sprinkles more water, and the lady smiles again. On another visit, an onlooker presses Bernadette to offer pen and ink to the lady, with the request that she write down her name. Bernadette obediently offers pen and paper. This causes the lady to laugh.
Then she says, "There is no need for me to write what I have to say. Would you be so kind as to come here for 15 days?" I promised. And then she said, "I do not promise you the happiness of this world, but of the other world."
At the sixth apparition, about 100 people are present. The local media exclaims, "Event so wonderful and extraordinary, we cannot keep silent. Every morning for the last 15 days, a young girl of Lourdes walks 2 kilometers. Bernadette is the daughter of a simple worker living off his daily labor." The day of that apparition, the lady looks away from Bernadette into the crowd. Casting a glance on each one, her face saddens. When she looks at Bernadette again, she says,
"Pray for sinners."
On Wednesday, the 24th of February, the message from the lady is,
"Penance, penance, penance. Pray for sinners. Kiss the ground as an act of penance for sinners."
Bernadette kneels at the entrance to the grotto and makes her way up on her knees, kissing the ground as she goes. Many people follow her example and get on their knees. On Thursday, the 25th of February, 300 people are present. When Bernadette comes out of her ecstasy, she says that the young lady asked her,
"Go to the spring to drink and wash from it."
But there is no water in the grotto. Bernadette looks helplessly around. She turns toward the lady again, asking her to indicate further what she means. Receiving an answer, she goes to the back of the cave, kneels at a sandy place, and starts to dig with her hands. After some time, she reaches first dampness, then mud, then water. The unbelievers mock the girl. Has she gone mad? But Bernadette replies,
"It is for sinners."
Because of the crowds, the authorities intervene. The local police commissioner, Mr. Jacquemet, questions Bernadette to uncover what he thinks is a hoax. But Bernadette cannot be broken down. She is also suspected of insanity. A group of doctors examine her. Most of them are unbelievers and do not take into account the possibility of the supernatural. But all they can say is that it is possible that Bernadette is suffering from hallucinations. Next, it is planned to arrest Bernadette. As the clergy seems to take no interest in the events, the mayor approaches the parish priest to prepare the way for the arrest. But Abbe Peyramal reacts surprisingly.
"Your doctors have not found a trace of mental trouble, and your conclusions are pure suppositions. You may tell the prefect that the police will find me on this poor family's threshold, and that they will have to pass over my body before they touch a hair of the little girl's head."
The mayor backs off. He fears a revolt of the people. Nonetheless, he has the grotto barricaded. On Monday, the 1st of March, over 1,500 people assemble at the grotto. The spring is now a narrow stream trickling down to the river. It dawns on some people that the source could be of an extraordinary nature. Bernadette has climbed to the spot of the spring and begun to dig at just the right spot. Nobody until then knew of any water coming out of the grotto. A mother, in desperation, plunges her dying baby into the cold water. Although the crowd voices its objections, the child's health is restored. The incredulity of most onlookers vanishes. Many become reverent. Except for Father Peyramal, the clergy continues to keep its distance from the events. However, the bishop and his priests are about to be thrown into the events. On Tuesday, March 2nd, the lady gives a message for the priests.
"Go. Tell the priest to build a chapel and have people come in procession."
Bernadette goes to Abbe Peter Mall, although she is very nervous about doing so.
I am Bernadette Soubirous.
Ah, so it's you. I've been hearing queer stories about you, my girl. Come in.
The lady at the grotto told me to tell the priest that she wants a chapel at Massabielle, so that's why I've come.
Yes, but who is that lady? Does she belong to Lourdes?
She isn't from Lourdes. I don't know her.
And you take messages like this from someone you don't know?
Oh, Father, this lady isn't like anyone else.
What do you mean?
I mean, she's as beautiful as I think people in heaven are.
There is a moment of silence during which the priest gets up and begins striding up and down the room. He stops and says, "You must tell the lady who sent you that the parish priest doesn't have dealings with people he doesn't know. That before everything else, he insists that she must give her name. And further, she must prove she has a right to it." On Thursday, the 4th of March, there are now 8,000 people waiting at the grotto. But to their disappointment, no vision occurs. For 20 days, Bernadette does not go to the grotto. She no longer feels the invitation. Finally, on Thursday, the 25th of March, the vision returns. This time, the lady speaks about herself at last.
I begged the lady to tell me who she was. The lady did as she had always done before. She bowed her head and smiled, but she did not reply. I cannot say why, but I felt bolder and asked her again to be so kind as to tell me her name. However, she only bowed and smiled as before, still keeping silence. Then, once more, for the third time, clasping my hands and acknowledging myself unworthy of the favor I was seeking of her, I again made my request. The lady was standing above the rose tree. Her face became very serious, and she seemed to bow down in an attitude of humility. Then, she joined her hands and raised them to her breast. She looked up to heaven. Then, slowly opening her hands and leaning forward towards me, she said to me, in a voice vibrating with emotion, "Que soy era Immaculata Concepción."
Immediately, the lady vanishes. Bernadette runs to the priest, repeating words that she does not understand. Que soy era Immaculata Concepción. I am the Immaculate Conception. When Abbe Peramal hears the phrase, he is shaken. It means that Mary was conceived without the wound of original sin, conceived in the same state of justice as Adam and Eve before the fall. That is what the angel meant when he said Mary was full of grace. It points as well to the woman of the book of Revelation, whose son is threatened by the serpent and who eventually crushes it. Four years earlier, in 1854, the successor of St. Peter, Pope Pius IX, had formally defined the Immaculate Conception as a dogma of the Church. We declare, pronounce, and define that the Blessed Virgin Mary, at the first instant of her conception, was preserved immaculate from all stain of original sin. By the singular grace and privilege of the omnipotent God, in virtue of the merits of Jesus Christ, the Savior of mankind. At the time of Bernadette, the doctrine of the Immaculate Conception is largely confined to the discussions of theologians and scripture scholars. It is not an expression known by the young Bernadette, who lives in a tiny village, speaks a dialect, and is barely literate. Thank you. It is going to be the last message of the lady. The faithful, the clergy, all men and women on earth are given the promises and requests of the lady. Above all, they are left with the plea to live their earthly lives in the footsteps of Jesus Christ through conversion, penance, and hope in the next world. They are also left a source of water, and year after year, cures of the sick.
I was taken back to my room. I began to feel cold inside. This feeling grew stronger and stronger, almost painful, and was spreading all over my body. I had the impression of falling into a sort of lethargy. It was then that the sensation of cold gradually gave way to one of gentle warmth. I felt life surging back into every part of me that had been paralyzed by my illness.
Pierre de Ruder, who had crushed his bones and come to Lourdes with his leg swinging freely, prays before the shrine. He asks for the grace to provide a livelihood for his family. Not knowing it, he has been cured. He arises and, hardly realizing it, walks without crutches. Sinking to his knees before the statue of Our Lady, he cries, "I'm kneeling." Rising, he walks around the grotto without help of any kind. In a matter of seconds, Pierre de Ruder's bones have been rejoined. His wife, seeing him, exclaims in amazement, then faints. As Jesus entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers, who stood at a distance and, lifting up their voices, said, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. For the last century and a half, thousands of people that were healed went to the priests and told them the good news, after which they visited the doctors. Before the cure must be recognized as a miracle, the church turns to science. It wants to avoid hallucinations, excess zeal, hoaxes. In the 18th century, Cardinal Lambertini set out criteria which have to be fulfilled for a cure to be declared a miracle.
Du moment où quelqu'un vient dire qu'il est guéri de quoi que ce soit, moi je dois faire un examen, un interrogatoire complet, et puis un examen clinique, physique, éventuel, voir. Moi je suis comme Saint Thomas, il faut que je vois, il faut que je touche, il faut que j'examine.
The spirit of the scientific criteria is that the former illness must have been serious, that the cure must be definitive, and finally, that there is no scientific explanation for it.
The scrutiny of someone who claims a miracle at Lourdes, it's great that that scrutiny is so serious and so deep, because it makes for anyone that should come, Christian or non-Christian, to know that when a miracle is proclaimed at the medical bureau as medically inexplicable and then by a bishop, it's after great scientific scrutiny.
At the Medical Bureau of Lourdes, doctors and scientists do not work to recognize a possible miracle. Almost the opposite. Their task is to try to explain the cure with a physical cause.
S'il vient de dire à l'église, en effet, on va commencer à douter, première chose. Hein, le malheureux, on va lui dire, ah ben, attendez, est-ce que vous n'avez pas rêvé? Est-ce que vous n'êtes pas un psychique? Est-ce que ce n'est pas de l'hystérie? Est-ce que vous étiez vraiment malade? Est-ce que vous êtes vraiment guéri? Est-ce que les examens que vous nous donnez sont bien les vôtres?
Finally, the duty nurse came over to me since I appeared uncomfortable, and I told her I had to get up. She couldn't believe her eyes. She was flabbergasted to see me walk. My first steps were hesitant, but I soon felt my legs grow firmer, even though they hadn't worked since 1984.
If the doctor on standby at Lourdes is in favor of a case, it is sent to the International Medical Committee. This committee is made up of some 20 members, respected in their own particular medical discipline. Doctors without Christian faith can take part in the analysis. The first criteria to be taken into account requires that the person have medical evidence of the illness, X-rays, blood analysis, hospital diagnosis.
Ben, Monsieur Belli, par exemple, donc miraculé de Lourdes 66, qui a guéri en 1987 d'une sclérose en plaques dont il souffrait depuis 15 ans, reconnu invalide à 100% à titre définitif avec tierce personne quand il est venu ici.
Secondly, for a healing to be considered as a miracle in Lourdes, modern medicine must not be able to cure that person. The person must be regarded as incurable.
I received 100% disability benefits from the Social Security and needed a caretaker to help with my everyday needs.
Thirdly, the cure must be definitive. Indeed, the person must be perfectly healed. The illness must not be simply dormant.
Mais M. Belli, je vous l'ai dit, vu donc en 93 par ce comité médical international, eh bien, ces spécialistes ont dit, ouh là là, on n'a que 6 ans de recul, une sclérose en plaques, c'est une maladie à rechute, par poussée, on va attendre 5 ans, ils ont remis ça à 5 ans.
In total, Jean-Pierre Belli underwent 12 years of investigations by numerous doctors. After a very intense discussion and vote, a majority of the doctors concluded that, in the light of the scientific data, it is today impossible to say more in explanation of this case. So the case moved from the medical level to the spiritual level. Now the church looks at how God may have been present in the life of the cured person and if the cure has come from heaven. The file is referred to the bishop of the diocese where the healed person lives. Being prudent about miracles was an example set by Jesus himself. In the desert, he refuses to perform a miracle when the demon demands one. Religion is not show business. Overall, Jesus does not want to be reduced to a performer of miracles. He wants people to understand that he brings more than physical healing. He brings salvation and eternal life. Physical healing is a sign that more important still is what is done in the depth of the soul. There, Christ heals the wound of original sin, allowing a life of grace. The first theological criteria for accepting a sudden healing as a miracle is that the cure must happen in association with Lourdes.
The morning of the final day, I underwent the anointing of the sick, which they call the sacrament of life. At the moment when the priest anointed my forehead and hands, I felt everything around me starting to spin. I suddenly lost all notion of time and space.
The church wants people to understand that salvation is at hand, that people must grab the opportunity and accept the Savior and live according to His heart. At the source of a physical or emotional healing, there is a healing of the human spirit.
Un signe avant-coureur de ce que sera la seule vraie guérison définitive, qui sera la résurrection. Alors un miracle, c'est une guérison qui est partielle et qui est provisoire, et qui n'affecte que quelques personnes, mais qui dit « on va vers la vie ».
Though sleeping soundly, I woke up at 3 o'clock. An idea I had never dreamed of was creeping into my head. Like an invitation, get up and walk. The urge became stronger and stronger.
Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, rise and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the man who was paralyzed, I say to you, rise, take up your bed and go home.
The Lord had just healed my heart. I was invaded by a powerful sense of liberation and inner peace, such as I had never experienced before. Thank you.
healings in Lourdes follow the spiritual path followed by Saint Bernadette.
Que faisait Bernadette? Quand elle arrivait à la grotte, elle se mettait à genoux devant la grotte. Elle faisait le signe de la croix très lentement et vraiment de tout son cœur, reconnaissant à la fois ce qu'elle est, faible, limitée, pécheur, et en même temps proclamant l'amour de Dieu manifesté dans la croix du Christ. Et ce signe de la croix que la Sainte Vierge lui avait appris à faire, lui faisait déjà faire l'expérience un petit peu du royaume des cieux, hein, passer par la croix de sa réalité à la réalité du Christ.
The sign of the cross is done with an angelic beauty, say witnesses. Only Bernadette can see the vision. The others see only her beaming face. But if it is beautiful, it is still, while making the sign of the cross, the sign of the crucifixion. In a world of broken bodies and confused minds, heaven comes to people who can kneel. The humble. On the walls of the cave, the cool gray stone has become shiny from the touch of the millions of pilgrims who admit their smallness and their dependence on God the Father. Our Lady's words are the exact antithesis of the promises of the world. I do not promise you the happiness of this world, but of the next.
Les pèlerins qui entrent dans la grotte de Lourdes et qui en sortent sont entrés d'une certaine façon dans l'expérience du mystère pascal. Ils ont porté à la grotte toutes leurs peines, toutes leurs souffrances, toutes leurs douleurs. Ils ont rencontré de façon mystérieuse, par la médiation de la Sainte Vierge, de la Vierge Immaculée, de la Vierge Marie, de la Mère de Dieu, ils ont rencontré le Christ crucifié et ressuscité qui lui les a fait passer avec lui de leur réalité à la sienne.
Then Mary says a rosary with Bernadette. What is the rosary? 20 episodes from the life of Christ, from the incarnation to the crucifixion, to the glorification, the life of Jesus who suffers with us. In Lourdes, Mary brings people to the Messiah, the good news spoken by Jesus Christ, love your God with all your heart, love your neighbor like yourself. Our deliverance is presented there. The next logical step is penance. Penance, 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 says Mary. Pray for sinners.
Avant de découvrir l'eau pure, elle a découvert l'eau, la boue qu'elle a mise sur son visage. Et ensuite, quand elle a découvert l'eau pure, elle a lavé son visage avec la boue. Et voici que les pèlerins de Lourdes qui accomplissent ce geste avec l'eau, eh bien disent peut-être dans le secret de leur cœur, dans leur prière, Seigneur, voilà, je suis sale à l'intérieur, je suis pécheur, j'ai telle et telle chose, mais je sais que toi, tu es la source de vie, lave-moi, purifie-moi.
I find people here to be very humble. People here either are sick, or they're with a sick person, or helping the sick, or they're here praying for someone sick. And I find that everyone who has sick family members or close friends, it changes their life a little bit. And they're not in your face with their faith, you know, oh, you should be doing this, this, and that, and I went to Mass 5 times today. They're very quiet about their faith, but they believe very strongly. They're very friendly to everyone, and they help everyone. And it's just really enjoyable being around these people.
Then may come an inner healing, sometimes a physical one. Jesus, by his sacrifice, brings reconciliation with the Father and therefore restores people to their real nature as children of God, living the plan of God. It only makes sense then that becoming healed deeply in their soul, they may also be healed in their body. In Lourdes, Christ passes through the crowd and heals. In Mark 6, we are told, and wherever he came, in villages, cities, or country, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and besought him that they might touch even the fringe of his garment, and as many as touched it were made well. Thank you. By the washing at the spring, Mary asks what heaven has always asked of humanity, an act of faith in the unique salvific source of her Son. Repentance from sin and washing with the grace of God. Go to the spring to drink and wash from it. Eventually, Mary asks for a church to be built. Today, a magnificent basilica, built by the people of God, stands on the hill above the grotto. Why is a church built? To be the temple of God, so that he may dwell among his people, so that the Holy Mass may be offered. Mass, the reenactment of the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross.
Le Christ va se rendre véritablement présent sur le dans le mystère de sa Pâque, dans le mystère de sa mort-résurrection, et nous-mêmes ensuite, communiant au corps du Christ mort et ressuscité, nous allons entrer dans ce passage sacramentel. Oui, c'est vrai, il est ressuscité. D'ailleurs, il m'a rejoint dans mon existence pour me faire passer à sa propre réalité. Voilà l'expérience extraordinaire, c'est l'Évangile.
Christ, by his life and by his death, has not cancelled unavoidable suffering, but he has transformed its role in our lives. He made of suffering a place of meeting with him, of participation in the salvation of the world. Suffering has become a door to the resurrection. All miracles are now possible because Christ was crucified and resurrected. The miracle which allows all others is the resurrection of Christ after his crucifixion. If there is a context to the miracles, there are also results to them. Miracles lead the former sick person to a holy life.
Ici, vous avez la photographie donc de la dernière miraculée de Lourdes, qui est Anna Santaniello, qui est une femme qui est venue ici à Lourdes à l'âge de 40 ans, qui était cardiaque au dernier point, et qui donc ne pouvait plus respirer, marcher, elle avait été cyanosée de partout, voilà. Et cette dame vit toujours, puisqu'elle a maintenant 97 ans, et elle a fini par être connue comme la 67e miraculée de Lourdes. Ça, c'est des photos que j'ai prises chez elle, où on la voit quand elle était jeune et puis aujourd'hui. C'est assez amusant. C'est la même personne. Puisque une fois qu'elle a guéri, elle m'a dit, hein, je l'ai vue l'année dernière, elle m'a dit, si j'ai guéri, si la Vierge m'a guéri, c'est pour, ça a été pour m'occuper des enfants malheureux de ma région. Elle habite dans la région de Salerne, au sud de Naples. En effet, il y a pas mal d'enfants abandonnés un peu partout.
Contrary to cures claimed by magicians, the cures in Lourdes do not cut the patient off from the world. Instead, they lead them to undertake charitable works. The bishop of the place where the healed person lives is the one who eventually declares a cure miraculous. This is the final step of the recognition of a miracle from Lourdes. In this way, 68 cures have been declared miracles. But in the eyes of people familiar with Lourdes and those who have come there, many more miracles occur. Because of the extremely demanding criteria used in the recognition of a miracle, many healings remain unknown. If one wanted to consider only the spontaneous healings examined by the Medical Bureau, one would state there have been 7,000 solid, spectacular cures that have been documented, but not declared miracles.
Donc ici on a les deux armoires qui contiennent les archives et celle-ci. Ici on a les plus anciennes. Par exemple, là vous avez les archives de 1913, hein, 1913. année après année et jour après jour, on note et on reprend des articles éventuellement de guérison de personnes. Alors, vous voyez, c'est quand même très riche. En gros, j'ai dans les 40-50 personnes par an, ce qui fait à peu près une personne par semaine en moyenne. Hein? D'accord. Voilà. Donc là, on a les années juste de début du XXe siècle. Et ici, on a des années à partir de 1900, après la guerre 14, jusqu'en 69. Voilà. Année après année. Quelquefois, il y en a plus, quelquefois, il y en a moins. Bon, il y avait quand même énormément de déclarations. Je peux vous dire qu'en tout, on a dépassé aujourd'hui les 7000 déclarations. Hein.
7000 declarations of spontaneous healings, and yet only 68 recognized as miracles. What causes so many cures to be rejected? For some, it is a discrepancy in the file. There are cases where proofs of the past disease are not sufficient. There are no x-rays, or the tests are too old. Then, there are the cases where medication has continued to be taken by the patient after the moment of being cured.
Ici, il y en a un autre. D'une personne qui s'appelle Sœur, qui est une sœur religieuse. Vous voyez, c'est à peu près la même épaisseur. Hein? 88, elle a guéri le 15 août 87, donc la même année que M. Belli. Eh bien, finalement, on a décidé qu'elle ne serait pas reconnue.
Ça aurait été psychosomatique.
Non, c'est que malheureusement, après sa guérison, elle a continué ses traitements. Or, si on veut appliquer à la lettre, les critères, après la guérison, on ne doit plus avoir de traitement.
Et elle, on peut savoir de quoi elle aurait été guérie ?
Elle a guéri d'une polyarthrite chronique évolutive, donc qui déformait complètement les mains, les pieds. Alors, elle a conservé une déformation des mains et des pieds, mais depuis ce jour-là, elle a une mobilité assez étonnante de ses mains et de ses pieds. Elle peut marcher, elle peut coudre, elle peut faire ce qu'elle veut. Ce qui est quand même assez étonnant.
The medical statement of definitive healing has become increasingly difficult to get from the medical bureau.
Si vous voulez, aujourd'hui, la difficulté, c'est que la médecine ne reconnaît plus tellement les guérisons. La médecine est devenue très, très en retrait par rapport au phénomène de guérison. Elle accepte des rémissions. Et aujourd'hui, on ne parle plus de guérison, on parle de rémission. Alors, hein, vous avez un cancer, la personne va mieux, très bien. Bon, on va lui dire, écoutez, très bien, on continue à vous suivre jusqu'à la fin de votre vie, parce qu'on ne sait pas si vous ne rechuterez pas dans 10 ans, dans 20 ans. Bon. Donc comment aujourd'hui nous dire cette personne est guérie définitivement, ce que demandent les critères officiels? On peut dire ça quoi? 5 ans après, 10 ans après, 20 ans après ou... Mais M. Belli, je vous l'ai dit, vu donc en 93 par ce comité médical international, eh bien ces spécialistes ont dit, oh là là, on n'a que 6 ans de recul, une sclérose en plaques, c'est une maladie à rechute, par poussée. On va attendre 5 ans, ils ont remis ça à 5 ans.
In the face of a long trial to certify a miracle, many people become discouraged. Today, many are not as willing to go through 200 medical tests.
J'ai vu 200 à 300 médecins, et puis en plus, des psychiatres, spécialement des examens psychiatriques pour être sûr que c'était pas une fausse maladie. Hein? Donc, au moins 400 psychiatres. Bon. Tout ça pendant jusqu'en 93. En 93, donc 6 ans après, on l'a présenté au Comité médical international de Lourdes, qui est un organisme supérieur, fondé il y a 51 ans, composé de chefs de clinique des hôpitaux, tous des grands spécialistes, qui vont reprendre le cas et qui vont à nouveau essayer d'y trouver à critiquer tel ou tel document qui ne serait pas juste. Hein. Et moi, il m'a fait la confidence qu'il a failli arrêter plusieurs fois et dire, bon, ça suffit, moi, je suis guéri, c'est l'essentiel, comme on ne kikine plus.
With so many challenges, bishops recognize miracles very late, sometimes perhaps too late. Miss Sant'Agnolo was recognized by her bishop 50 years after her healing. She was then 98 years old. One year later, she passed away from natural causes.
Le problème, c'est qu'il y a peu de gens, finalement, aujourd'hui, à mon avis, qui se déclarent. Hein, sur les 40-50 que j'ai tous les ans, il y en a certainement 10 fois plus qui ne se déclarent pas. Sûrement. à vue de nez, hein, c'est un peu le feeling là, mais d'après les recoupements que je peux faire, il y a beaucoup plus de gens qui ne se déclarent pas qu'il y en a qui se déclarent, aujourd'hui. Alors qu'il y a 100 ans, c'était l'inverse. Les gens se faisaient un plaisir de se déclarer, étaient contents de voir des médecins et de venir parler. Aujourd'hui, quand on est guéri, on a envie d'être tranquille. Et je les comprends de certaine façon.
This is not to mention healings that are difficult to track because they are cures of the inner life. Healing from depression, deep wounds of childhood, abortion, destructive habits, the consequences of injustice, betrayal, and persecution. Obsessions with the wrong things, such as luxury and fashion. Laziness, the desire for power or revenge, all wounds of sin that weigh on the soul. Such healings also occur, as the friends of the formerly afflicted can attest. Should so few healings be known? On one hand, the Church wants to make sure that all miracles are true. But on the other hand, it must be thankful for any healing given by God. In this situation, the Bishop of Lourdes notes that there are persons who had an extraordinary healing. They are now healthy. Unfortunately for the cause of the miracle, they have been treated medically after the healing. There are also persons whose diagnosis of the former illness is questioned. Following the canonical definition, those cures will never be recognized as miraculous. Up to now, the person healed was told to keep quiet. I have experienced that twice in the diocese where I was formerly bishop. Should the scientific roadblock be a reason to leave the world uninformed about so many spontaneous healings? After all, Jesus wanted God's healing work to be praised. Weren't 10 lepers healed? Where are the others? For all these reasons, the Bishop of Lourdes is recommending to adapt the criteria to the medical knowledge of our time.
Un effort pour à l'approche du 150e anniversaire de Lourdes, puisque 2008 sera le jubilé du 150e anniversaire, de se mettre à jour, non pas au point de vue religieux, mais au point de vue de la médecine. C'est ça qu'il faut essentiellement comprendre dans les nouvelles procédures proposées pour la reconnaissance des guérisons. C'est que la foi de l'Église, elle n'a pas changé, et ses convictions à propos du miracle n'ont pas changé. Mais par contre, à l'égard de la recherche médicale, la situation évidemment n'a rien à voir entre 2006 et les origines de Lourdes.
The full-fledged criteria would be kept for the official, rare, recognized cases of miracles. But the other thousands of healings would also be made known as spontaneous healings.
Avant d'arriver au terme d'une reconnaissance canonique de miracles, il faudrait trouver un créneau, c'est ce qu'on essaie de faire, une ouverture, pour que des personnes qui ont vécu en profondeur une guérison, quelle qu'elle soit, physique certes, mais aussi peut-être psychique et spirituelle, quelque chose de plus profond, déclarer, constater, analyser, confirmer par la médecine et par pluridisciplinairement, pas seulement la médecine, mais aussi par d'autres, puissent éventuellement témoigner de leur guérison dans un cercle privé pour l'édification de la communauté des croyants, pas pour les médias.
In light of the situation, Bishop Perrier expresses his recommendation. I wish that in this type of situation, the person may be allowed to testify to the grace received. The recognition of the miracle in the canonical sense will still go on. Hoaxes must be barred. But it is my wish that the bishops who have someone in their diocese who was unquestionably cured in Lourdes, after all the verifications mentioned, should authenticate them. Most of the doctors ask for nothing more.
Moi, je suis scientifique d'une part, mais croyant d'autre part. Donc, je suis ouvert à une autre possibilité qui est la cause surnaturelle. Voilà. Mais il y a des scientifiques croyants qui sont médecins, il y en a d'autres qui sont astrophysiciens. Hein. C'est pas interdit.
The growing difficulty in recognizing miracles reflects how people thought in the last century. Many in society came to believe that science was the only form of knowledge. Mystical or spiritual knowledge, for example, was put aside. Now humanity can return to a balanced way of judgment, using the different forms of knowledge: science, faith, theology.
J'estime que c'est très médical, en tout cas, parce que si on ne prend pas en compte la dimension spirituelle de la personne, on fait de la médecine vétérinaire. Moi, mon chat, il a un psychosomatique. Il est psychosomatique. Hein? Le chien et même le canard. Tandis que l'homme, il a quelque chose de plus qui est qu'il peut s'émerveiller et puis qu'il peut s'ouvrir sur la dimension d'éternité et sur l'invisible. C'est très important pour nous médecins, encore une fois, de ne pas opposer la science et la foi, mais de voir que c'est complémentaire, même dans notre pratique médicale.
One physician, Dr. Van Hoesterberg, was a freethinker. He refused to believe the miracle of Pierre de Ruder until he had thoroughly examined him himself. Still, 23 years after the death of Pierre, the doctor was skeptical. He asked to exhume the body. The examination of the legs, to his amazement, revealed a piece of healthy white bone, over an inch long, between two other sections still pockmarked by the long disease. Dr. Van Hoesterberg was so deeply moved that he prayed for the grace of belief and became a Christian and a Catholic. What keeps many from believing in miracles, even if they believe in God, is that they have forgotten that God is the maker of the laws of the universe. What is an extraordinary healing if not a situation where the laws as we know them are dramatically altered? But if God is the maker of the laws, it is just as easy for him to alter them. Actually, the healings in Lourdes do not contradict the rules of health. They restore them, and very fast. The flesh seems deficient and disease has set in, but God reestablishes his rule of good health, the good order he had established at the beginning. Where original sin has allowed disease to set in, God, by the crucifixion of Christ, allows good order to be restored. In Lourdes, Mary calls everyone to come back to her son. Because of her mediation, healings occur to sick people and to the apparently healthy, too. Healings that are signs of a deeper healing for humanity, flowing from the victory won by Christ over original and personal sin. The grace flowing from the cross heals souls and it heals bodies.
I'm sure anyone will grow and anyone will get some kind of healing from coming here, if it's physical or spiritual, emotional, but something happens for everyone, I believe that. And it's just, so peaceful. I wish I could come here every year and do, you know, a retreat and just center myself and spend all that time with our Lady and the Lord.
In Lourdes, people of all nations, united in their hope and their need, come where Bernadette saw heaven open. They come by the river where the Lady asked, "Will you do me the favor of coming here for 15 days?" They come in humility, repentance, and the will to be holy. At the grotto, anybody can lay his burdens aside. It is free of charge. At the baths, at the way of the cross, during adoration, or in confession, everyone is invited to experience how heaven opens. On Thursday, the 16th of July, 1858, Bernadette receives her last call to the grotto. Since access is blocked by some barriers, she stays on the other side of the river.
I felt that I was in front of the grotto, at the same distance as before. I saw only the Blessed Virgin. Never was she more beautiful.